Now, unfortunately, when Jesus introduced the law of Christ 2,000 years ago, many people found it hard letting go of the old system and embracing the new. The Jews had lived under the law of Moses for so long that it had become part of their whole culture and identity. Moses was their most revered prophet. And now, here was Jesus telling them that he superseded Moses and that the old law had been fulfilled in him and made obsolete. What's more, whereas the law of Moses had been intended just for the nation of Israel, the law of Christ was opening up God's message to the entire world. There was a sudden influx of people into the faith from all over, people with no Jewish heritage or culture at all, people known as Gentiles. As these Gentiles came into the faith, the Jews were a little jealous and angry. Actually, they were outraged. A bit like when a new baby arrives into a household and the older child is put out because he isn't the sole focus of attention anymore. They couldn't believe that God wanted to accept these awful pagans from surrounding nations. God made it clear to them that he was accepting the Gentiles whether they liked it or not. So after they'd come to terms with it, the Jews puffed out their chests and began telling the newbies, "Well, we don't like it, but if you Gentiles are going to start worshipping our God, you're going to need us to show you how we do things around here. You're going to need to be circumcised, celebrate our holidays and festivals, subscribe to our laws on diet and clothing." Essentially, they were trying to impose the old law of Moses on the Gentiles and make them culturally Jewish. The people that tried to do this are known as the Judaizers. The Gentiles were confused. When they heard the gospel for the first time from the likes of Peter and Paul, they were told that all they needed to do was put their faith in Jesus for salvation and that would be enough. And so they did. And God confirmed to them that it was enough because he gave them his Holy Spirit and performed signs and wonders amongst them as soon as they believed. But now, here were these group of Jews saying that actually, faith alone wasn't enough, that they needed to add the old Jewish rituals and traditions and laws too. This whole issue led to the apostles forming a council to discuss the issue, and it's recorded in the book of Acts chapter 15. Some of the men who had been Pharisees before their conversion stood up and declared that all the Gentile converts must be circumcised and be required to follow the law of Moses. So the apostles and church elders got together to decide this question. At the meeting, after a long discussion, Peter stood and addressed them as follows. "Brothers, you all know that God chose me from among you some time ago to preach to the Gentiles, so that they could hear the good news and believe. God, who knows people's hearts, confirmed that he accepted the Gentiles by giving them the Holy Spirit, just as he gave him to us. He made no distinction between us and them, for he also cleansed their hearts through faith. Why are you now questioning God's way by burdening the Gentile believers with a yoke that neither we nor our ancestors are able to bear? We believe that we are all saved the same way, by the special favor of the Lord Jesus." So Peter effectively said, "Look, the old law of Moses was a burden that none of us have been able to bear. None of our ancestors could bear it either. All it led to was pride, legalism, hypocrisy, bondage, and death. So why are you trying to resurrect it and lay that burden on the Gentiles? Why are you trying to bring Judaism into Christianity when the new spirit-filled life under Christ is so much better than the old? Let the law of Moses go. We're all saved the same way, by simple faith in what Jesus did for us on the cross." You'll be unsurprised to hear that it was the legalistic Pharisees that had the hardest time letting go of the law of Moses, and unfortunately, Peter's words did not deter them. Legalists are never easily deterred. Derek Prince says, "Legalism has a great hold on the human mind. It appeals to our human pride. That is why people can be passionately dedicated to a legalistic religion." These guys were so passionately dedicated to their legalism that they started secretly following the apostles on their missionary journeys around Asia and Europe. The apostles would go from town to town preaching the true gospel, planting new churches, and then once they had left and gone on to the next town, the Judaizers would sneak in behind them to confuse and pervert the message. Paul knew what they were doing and said to the elders in Ephesus, "I know that false teachers like vicious wolves will come in among you after I leave, not sparing the flock. Even some men from your own group will rise up and distort the truth to draw a following." Satan always has his agents trying to pervert the truth, and here we see him using a trademark fifth column tactic to even plant his agents within the churches themselves. The most famous example of Judaizers coming in after Paul had visited an area was in Galatia. They began trying to discredit him. They told the Galatians that Paul wasn't even a real apostle and not to be trusted. They told them that he hadn't given them the whole story. They said that faith in Jesus was good, but they had to add to it the law of Moses. Unfortunately, many of the Galatians started to listen to this pollution, so Paul wrote a letter to the Galatians, at first establishing his credentials as an apostle, and then pleading with them not to listen to this false teaching of the Judaizers. He wrote, "Some so-called Christians, false ones really, came to spy in us and see our freedom in Christ Jesus. They wanted to force us like slaves to follow their Jewish regulations, but we refused to listen to them for a single moment. We wanted to preserve the truth of the good news for you." Later, Paul writes, "We have believed in Christ Jesus that we might be accepted by God because of our faith in Christ, and not because we have obeyed the law, for no one will ever be saved by obeying the law." In fact, he says, "I make myself guilty if I rebuild the old system I already tore down." Getting exasperated, he exclaims, "Have you lost your senses? After starting your Christian lives in the Spirit, why are you now trying to become perfect by your own human effort?" He goes on, "Those who depend on the law to make them right with God are under his curse, for the scriptures say, 'Cursed is everyone who does not observe and obey all these commands that are written in God's book of the law.'" If you wish to find life by obeying the law, you must obey all of its commands. Paul tells them that if they try to stay right with God by keeping the law, then they have to obey all 613 of them perfectly, and because they'll never be able to do it, they'll just put themselves under the curse of death, like the Israelites of old. David Pawson writes, "If we tell people to keep the law of Moses, we are consigning them to hell, because they cannot do it." Paul continues in his letter to the Galatians saying, "Christ has rescued us from the curse pronounced by the law. When he hung on the cross, he took upon himself the curse for our wrongdoing." Getting even more exasperated, he writes, "You are trying to find favor with God by what you do or what you don't do on certain days or months or seasons or years. I fear for you. I am afraid that all my hard work for you was worth nothing. Dear brothers and sisters, I plead with you to live as I do in freedom from these things, for I have become like you Gentiles were, free from the law." He goes on to say, "So Christ has truly set us free. Now make sure that you stay free and don't get tied up again in slavery to the law." And then he repeats the law of Christ, saying, "What is important is faith expressing itself in love. And the whole law can be summed up in this one command, love your neighbor as yourself." You can hear the emotion building throughout Paul's letter as he pleads with them not to go back to the old system with its oppressive list of rules that lead to death. He wants them just to accept Jesus' sacrifice for them by faith and then love God and one another with all their heart, mind, soul, and strength. That is the freedom that they were rejecting by listening to these Judaizers. I want to say clearly that if you want to become a Christian, you don't have to become culturally Jewish. Part of the beauty of Christianity is the diversity which it allows. Because God looks at internal motives over external actions, we have true freedom in worship. So the way Africans worship God is very different to the way Asians worship God, and that's very different to the way that Europeans worship God. The instruments are different, the clothes are different, the hairstyles are different. All of it's great. Christianity doesn't demand an imposition of culture on anyone. The new earth is going to be a colorful place when we get there. People from every tribe, tongue, and language, and it will be all the better for it. Judaizing is still a problem today, most recently through the likes of the Hebrew Roots Movement and Sacred Name Movement, which you may have heard of. Ignore this kind of thing. It serves no good purpose. Before proceeding to the next part, take the time to read the book of Galatians. In the light of what you've learned so far, let Paul's words come alive and soak into your mind and into your heart.